Well, thank you for attending. I appreciate you guys' interest in what I've done in my naval career and my animal rescue career. So I just wanted to start off with a little bit of background about myself and how I came into this type of adventure, I guess you could call it, or passion. So I grew up in Hawaii with European parents, and I spent my life on the sea. Sailed. We have a 44-foot sailboat, and I race small boats also. So while I was in high school, I joined the junior ROTC program because I was chasing after a boy, and I thought, oh, what better way to get known than to join the NOAA program? So I did, but I found out that I loved it. I loved running and jumping and the Rangers side of it. It was the Army program. So that had a big influence in my decision to come out to the Naval Academy and participate in serving my country. And the other thing that happened in high school was I joined the Save the Animals Club, and I found out about animal testing for consumer products, and I was appalled and outraged, and at 15 I became a vegetarian. So that has been instilled in me, and compassion is in my soul and heart since I learned about it since I was 15, maybe since I was born. So, I just wanted to also share with you that one little clip that we have, just to give you an idea about time with Sea Shepherd Ship and what it was like, because I'm going to start talking about my time with the Navy and the differences that there was. So it's going to be a brief clip on what life was like, as well as the kind of interactions that we had with ship. So if you don't know, I'm class of 02. I studied oceanography here. My goal was to be selected for special operations. And I worked very hard at that, but I was not selected.
Let's go and see the stars, the Milky Way, or even Mars. Well, it could just be ours. Let's fade into the sun, let your spirit fly, for we are one.
We lean all day, and some say they ain't productive. Could that depend upon the demon that you're stuck with? Cause right now, I see clearer than most. I sit here contented with this cheese on toast. I feel the pain of a third world famine. Said we, count them blessings and keep jamming. Chism, scumbag, scum of the earth. His worth was nil until he gained the skill of tongues. From 15 years young, straight to my grey back self, I stay top shelf material. Jerk chicken, jerk fish. Break away, slave bliss. Generate G's and then be stashing with the Swiss. Fools can't see this. Under your pistols, a fist full of hip-hop duns. I progressing in the flesh. Esoteric quotes, most frightening. Duffy took a hold of my hand while I was writing. Leg on me tinged up and leg on me an. I summon up the power of Banana Clan. Witness the fitness, the prophet liveth. One hope, one quest. Witness the fitness, the prophet liveth. One hope, one quest. Witness the fitness, the prophet liveth. One hope, one quest. Witness the fitness, the prophet liveth. One hope, one quest. Swigging that heat root juice, Now we there burning booths, set them spirit them loose. Go ahead, go slash up the news. We conclusive proof about the truth, the right. Cause whether we hitchhike or push bike or travel kind of trash, manifest that with oats and roots rap. Manifest that, yeah, I do my zing way. Ain't nothing else I know. Got up in the life with this Iraqi bone flow. Squeeze the pain from my belly and set my soul free. Travel over ocean, land and sea. Face enough stress and difficulty. Flung back from the brink, whining kinda stink. We don't give a frig about what them fools think. Trigger network, our network will speak for itself. Proof of the trophy and the champion belt. Come sun, come rain, come hailstone pelt. Witness the fitness, the prophets and living. One hope, one quest. Witness the fitness, the prophets and living. One hope, one quest. Witness the fitness, the prophets and living. One hope, one quest. Yeah. Wanna see me with some old time shit. Let the old world know we's on some off key tip. Mega manic, when time the pressure start lick. By the hook or by the crook, by the poop or by the kick. He sickly cryptic, spitting the
Okay, so I thought that would give you an idea of a couple things. It showed a little bit about the equipment that we had on board, the personalities that were there, and the type of engagement we were involved in. And that particular clip showed, it was a day where we had 300 meter visibility, and we happened to come up on the blind spot of a spotter ship, and so we surprised them. The picture of the guy looking like this, he didn't know we were there. They didn't even see us on their radar. So that's the type of interaction we were doing, very different from the Navy. How did I find myself out there? Well, I knew that I wanted to travel and work with animals, so I spent my 6.5 years and I saved all my money. So I was able to volunteer and do things like this. I knew I wanted to get to Antarctica the year I got out of the military, and I applied to Raytheon for a job and also to Sea Shepherd, and thankfully Sea Shepherd accepted me. And I went with them on this campaign. So, I take it, does anyone not know about Sea Shepherd? No, I need to go about their history. Okay. So, I don't know, we could talk about some of the differences. One thing that was interesting, we don't have uniforms on the ship. There was music playing on the bridge. You saw a photo of, like, five of us dancing. That was normal. You could sit on whatever you wanted to. We didn't have to rewrite the logbook if there was three mistakes. They cursed it. You could stamp all over it and draw. There were still 4 hours on, 8 hours off watches. We still did have our jobs of being a quartermaster and taking logs, having a vigilant look, watch. Evolutions weren't, you know, it was a lot more mellow. We didn't have a lot of training going on, so Peter Brown is right, we just go and do it. But what I noticed in particular was that there was a lot of stress on the bridge. So how the checklist came about was, it was our very first boat launch, and the bridge didn't know what the boat deck was doing. And I said, how are you communicating with each other? Radios, and they said, no, the batteries died, we don't use radios. So, what are you doing? Oh, well, the captain's down there. He's out there, so he does it. But there's still a lot of stress in the bridge, so I put someone out on the bridge wing, and I opened a window, and there was an easy flow of communication, and the stress just went down, and we did that every time. So that was the initial step to kind of having things run smoothly, and I realized, well, we can know what the boat deck is doing, but we're still not quite on the same page, so this checklist that was created was a 9-step list, 9 steps to launch and 7 steps to recover. Very easy, do it a couple times, you've got it memorized. So it wasn't, you know, 8 hours of training to get 9 steps memorized. And people loved it. It worked very well. We were all on the same page. And there was just, for some reason, one person that didn't agree with it. So, you know, I think having that checklist was one of my greatest contributions to Sea Shepherd. I wrote down 2 others that I thought I contributed, and these are all things that I got out of the Navy. It's not my personality or anything, but launching the small boat checklist, the bridge to boat deck communication, just posting someone on the bridge wing so they can talk to each other. And then having the emergency procedures for man overboard, abandoned ship, and collision. We were in port, and majority of the people who were on board, we had 40 people, eight of those were camera crew, hadn't been out to sea. So they didn't know what to do if something happened, and we weren't training them. And it was 2 days before we had to get underway, so I got the mates together, let's talk about the training. The first mate didn't want to be a part of it, didn't really care for the volunteers, never really had. And I think it's because the way they used to get their volunteers was going to the bar and say, hey, do you have anything to do? We need some crew. We're going down to Antarctica. Let's go. And so people who didn't have anything to do would join them. And that's how they were getting their crew until whale lures came out and people found out about them and were applying, who had skills. So Peter Brown didn't particularly care for the volunteers. I don't know if that's to say he didn't care for their lives. But we had to have these procedures. Everyone was very nervous. So we had training on man overboard and collision and abandoned ship. So people had their abandoned ship gear bags ready to go, ship sank, and felt a whole lot more comfortable just from that. We posted all the procedures on the head, and just what I learned from the Navy. Keep reading and educating yourself while you're on the head. one of the interesting things I wasn't prepared for, you know, I'm a pretty liberal person. The personalities I was a little bit right of, but I understood and I enjoyed their personalities. But I didn't really know how to drive a ship. I was an excellent conning officer, an excellent officer of the deck, but I hadn't physically had the helm. So when I got the chance to do that on Sea Shepherd, because that's what we did, we drove the ship, we didn't have helmsmen, and I wasn't the conning officer, it was hard. So you give your helmsman some respect. It's a little bit tricky to get yourself steering on the right course and steady on course. So that needed some, you know, I needed practice with that. That was kind of interesting. And the other thing about it, you know, the Navy life exhausts you because you're constantly dealing with people and having things run smoothly and learning. With Sea Shepherd, it was exhausting because it was constant adrenaline going. Our first month we went down there, there was firestorms. We weren't with the fleet, but there was firestorms that we had to deal with. Then when you're with the fleet, it's not 24/7. You know, we start early at 6 a.m. and then we end at 6 p.m. The captains somehow have that kind of agreement going on. But it's really tiring if you have your 4 hours of watch on and your 8 hours of watch off, or 8 hours off. So, I don't know, it blended nicely, but needless to say, I don't know if I really did quite fit in with the group. I got booted, I wanted to go back, I wanted to be part of it. That was my passion, animal rescue, and to be part of direct action is every animal rights dream, rather than saving animals behind a desk. You want to be out there. So if you saw season 2, some of my interviews were kind of critical of the captain, what we were doing, just speaking what happened. Some of it was editing, and some of it was misunderstanding, but he didn't appreciate it, so that's why I'm not with him anymore. Otherwise, I'd still be there. So any questions from you guys?
While you started thinking of a question, there was one thing that came up this morning during class. And during season 2, how many of you have watched the show, Whale Wars? Most of you, all right. There was a collision. Do you want to talk about what your experience was during that collision and what precipitated that and how you planned for it?
We're limited by our fuel and our food and our water. We don't have a water maker, so we have to be really concerned about how we use it. And we knew we'd been out there for almost a month and that we were going to have to head back home. So the captain wanted to do something dramatic. And that was the big collision that we did in season 2. The idea was to clip their stern. So it was the factory ship, Sea Shepherd behind them on our starboard quarter, in between the harpoon ship that had a whale that wanted to transfer. So Sea Shepherd did a right rudder, tried to clip the stern of the harpoon vessel so it would turn in to the whaling ship. Well, they're very sturdy and nothing happened. You know, we just went up them and came back down and had a tear in our hull. So despite all the emergency procedures that were laid out, we've been doing these activities for 5 days. I was in my rack, one of the few people that was sleeping, and I got woken up because I got pushed out of my bunk and I heard the hull tear. So I hear this hull tear and I just know if there's water pouring in, I probably won't make it out. So I'm thinking this as I'm putting my shoes on, I'm putting my jacket out, and I open my door and there's no water. So I felt relieved, but I was so upset because we had signals to give people within the ship. If you're not topside, you don't know that there's brace for a collision. You need to give a signal for that. And that didn't happen. So, you know, thankfully no one got injured. There's no engineer walking down the stairs carrying something that could have fallen over. But, you know, that's something that they learn and aren't quite used to doing it that way. But it should have happened, and I think hopefully we will continue doing that. But for that collision, it was a big push because we knew we had to leave. So, you know, we had a couple of collisions, but we weren't being effective. It was interesting. So, Sea Ship, Paul Watson has been known to ram ships and sink ships. So that's what he uses on his, to threaten, I guess, the other whaling ships to keep them on the run, is to have them think that he's going to sink them. So they want to stay away from us, so they're going at speed of, you know, 15 knots to get away from us. And we always thought if they're going 15 knots, there's no way they can whale. There's no way they can transfer a whale, so we're saving whales, just as long as they're running away. And this is the first time that they killed whales going at 15 knots. They killed them, they transferred a whale going 15 knots, and we just didn't think it was possible. So that was lesson learned for Sea Shepherd that year, and it was a big blow to kind of our spirits, because we didn't know what they were doing while we would see them the months prior. So we didn't know what was going on, but they had killed three whales while we were alongside. And, you know, our speeds are so similar, it's hard. If we lose some distance, it's hard to get back up. So anytime we do see a harpoon ship, we launch the small boats. So the small boats get launched because we can't keep up with the harpoon vessels. Send them out, they launch prop valves. Hopefully they work. So that's what we do for those boats. And for the processing plant in Mishimaru, we want to stay on their starboard quarter. The kind of, you know, we do use a little bit of the rules of the road in our engagement. So if we stay at their starboard quarter and they decide to turn into us, we have right away. So we use that in our defense. But we just want to stay there to prevent any sort of transfer. And the longer you can prevent a whale transfer means that they won't be going out to kill another, and the longer it will stay in the water alongside, the meat gets tainted, so they can't sell it and lose money. So that's kind of the logic.
All right, we've got about 10, 12 minutes for questions. No one from CNAP here?
Jay Rob, I'm the chief captain. What kind of licenses did you have on board the ship? You know, what were the backgrounds of the officers on board the vessel? And, you know, were they unlimited licenses? What can you tell me about the licenses?
Sure. It was classified a motor yacht, so you don't technically need a license. But there was one license, unlimited timing. Person, young, very capable, been at sea for many years, and he was our go-to guy. He was kind of in the ranks, but also was wary that his license would be revoked, so didn't want to be in the limelight that much, but we did have a license personal board, but wasn't the captain. So, based on what we got, no one came to be there, so we classified it as such.
Was it classified, you know? Like Marshall Islands, Liberia,
it's flagged under the Netherlands.
Okay.
Midshipman Ridge Altonis. When I watched the show in preparation, because I had never heard of it before I got the email, the captain seemed to have no regard for human life, whether it was, you know, the Japanese sailors, which I can understand coming from his background, but also the people of his own crew. And he was so willing to not train them, like you said, or not put them in a position to succeed, and he would get so mad at them. Did you was that kind of the show dramatizing it, or was he really as wholehearted towards humans as it was portrayed?
Well, first off, for what you saw on the show, the first season was a little bit dramatized, however you want to put it. The rest of it was just filming what was happening, and he did expect us to take responsibility for why we were there. Most of us didn't fear for our lives. I particularly thought there was an underlying theme for both sides that the captains would rescue the other crew if they could be. So if our ship sank, I expected the Japanese to come to our rescue, and it would be the same person. While we were out there, because there was so much adrenaline, it was, you know, we were very close to having full collisions within 10 feet multiple times. And he would still do things like crazy diving, but he'd been doing it for 25 years, and he's still around, so are his vessels. So there was some, comfort in that. But he did have a regard for our lives, but he thought we were adults and we were there for a reason and we would risk it, so he's not going to worry about it. So what came off was, you know, correct.
Midshipman Calmus, could you remind me of the captain's name one more time? I'm not familiar with the show terribly.
His name's Paul Watson.
Paul Watson. When Commander Chris Raleigh was here 2 days ago, he was talking, there was a question about the sustainability of the program if it were to lose the captain, and how, if he has any like backup behind him, or is the entire organization based off of his personality and his drive? If he were to go down or something were to happen to him, would the program be able to survive without him?
Yeah. The program could definitely survive without him. Peter Hammer would probably be his predecessor, or the one that would just take over for him. But he does have something that is unique to him, and I don't know if charisma would be the right word, machismo. There is something that he protrudes out to us that the people that I've seen don't have. But those beneath him have a lot of respect from the crew that have been there. The mission is respected from the animal rights perspective. So they're never going to have a lacking of crew. The passion in the crew is there, but I think it would have to be tag team. So two of them would have to have one right to kind of do what one person's done if you were to step down. At the moment, I haven't seen one yet out there. He's very good at using the media, and he's given effective and emotional speeches that get people on the heart, so it would be happy to be something like that. And there's well-spoken people, just a little bit more emotion, I think.
Shoot your glass, you want? Ma'am, you talked about some of the offensive tactics that you guys used to sway the whalers, along with some of the defensive tactics that they used. Could you elaborate on this a little more? Maybe you talk about the prompt founders and your position relative to the whaling ship, and then the defensive moves that the whalers did, they sped up. Were there any other tactics that they used in, for yourself as well?
Well, the idea is they wanted to get us away from the factory ship. So we would find ourselves doing circles for 6 hours. And we would be doing circles. They'd use the LRAD and try and have us lose our bearings for the hoses for the small boats. Every time we were with the fleet, we would launch the small boat because they were most effective when we get closest. The purpose of the butyric acid is to taint the meat so it can't be sold, so they would lose money that way. But a lot of the times the fleet would leave and then come back. It was just very eerie, a very strange game that was being played. And just the scenery for it, it would be fog, and all of a sudden you'd see these three vessels coming in formation at you, and those were the harpoon vessels, and you didn't know what was going to happen. But it was like a game out there. We played Crazy Ivan, so kind of like chicken, I don't know what good that did, but we did it. Maybe it's still a little bit of fear, I guess. But yeah, things are changing now. More vessels, more distractions on our part. Better helicopters with longer ranges so we can find them sooner. But it's kind of, you know, our ship speed works with their factory vessel and our small boats work with the Hercules to keep up with them. So kind of goes paired like that.
Has the tsunami that occurred in Japan last year changed anything?
No, in fact, it's what I read. I haven't heard it firsthand that they used some of the tsunami relief funds to sustain their whaling this year. They have a new maritime force, and I'm not sure if it's their own security vessel or if it's just the people. I think it's the vessel.
People.
So they've upped their ante and have used the money for the relief, the relief fund for that. Otherwise, I hadn't heard. They did, you know, they would do things like say, well, we're gonna kill 50 humpbacks this year. And then everyone would say, no, you can't do that. Well, what are you gonna give us that we want? So they would throw things out there to get a bit of leverage for other things, which was interesting. They've got a lot of tactics. You know, we're battling this not only at sea, but you know, Greenpeace used to go out and do this, but they don't like what Sea Shepherd's doing. So they've decided to go to the country and do a more educational approach. So it's getting, you know, they're getting battered in all sorts of different ways. But I haven't seen anything.
We've got 2 or 3 minutes left for a couple or two more questions.
Shane Poole, ma'am, you talked about how the captain has used tactics for such as like direct ramming and even causing ships to sink. If that were to happen during one of your missions, do you really think that both sides, the Sea Shepherd and the Japanese whalers, would truly feel inclined to save the people of the sinking vessel? I mean, this seems a little bit of the captain.
He wants the people don't have evil hearts. You know, they're there for a job. They're an engineer, they got a job on the ship. It happens to be a whaling ship. So we just want the ship to be gone. You know, takes money out of their pocket. It can't do the killing. So yeah, there is regard for human life. We would go there and save their lives. I believe.
Another quick question.
Okay, Lieutenant Cruz, as a viewer, I found myself getting frustrated with the navigation and seamanship of the crew, with them losing their small boats sometimes or going the wrong direction. Did you ever find yourself frustrated with how they performed on the bridge? And you probably tried to change things, but how did you feel? Because as a viewer, I was very frustrated with how they were trying to boat.
Yeah, well, we didn't practice or talk about any sort of radio talk or radio procedure. So things would get garbled. They weren't efficiently spoken over the radio. There didn't seem to be much regard for the people in the small boats. They were the ones risking their lives, really. They were in some tough, ridiculous seas. They'd be out there with no food for 8-10 hours. How they got lost. I really liked the crew that year, so I think they were competent people. Something happened, batteries died. Visibility was bad, so I can understand it. And you know, they were some of my favorite people, PhDs. The bridge handled it kind of in waiting. They weren't going to send out another boat for looking for the other. If a small boat was usually launched because there was another vessel and Sea Shepherd didn't want to lose the other vessel, the Japanese whaling fleet vessel, so we wouldn't necessarily turn around as our first thing. We'd stick with the vessel and have to be finals. So, worked out okay.
Unfortunately, that's all the time we have today. It's 13:20, so we got to wrap it up. Thank you very much.
Thank you.